Our guest today is the Executive Director of the Illinois Housing Development Authority. She was appointed just 15 months ago and has been in the housing industry for more than 20 years. Our guest today grew up in Johnson County in southern Illinois. We got some Johnson County people. There we go. Thank you. Welcome. She earned her bachelor's and master's degree in urban and regional planning from the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. There we go. We got a lot of U of I guys, men and women. Ladies and gentlemen, Audra Hamernik. Audra?
All right. Have fun up here. Thank you. As Jay said, I grew up in deep southern Illinois, a town of 1,000 named Gourville. We would shop in nearby Carbondale and Paducah, Kentucky. And I had a great childhood. If you think about the Andy Griffith Show, the color version, that was my life. I'm happy to report, by the way, that Gourville is like thriving. It's this small little town. My uncle happens to be mayor, but there's new businesses. There's all these things going on. So hey, you know, my parents were married and they lived together in the same house. They both had jobs. My dad worked for the Bureau of Prisons and my mother was a bookkeeper for the school district. And I went to school every day with my mother. I remember even as a kid having a great sense of pride that both of my parents had good jobs, whatever that meant, and worked hard. And I had loving, wonderful grandparents, especially grandmothers. One is still loving, very active, and is one of these people that you can expect a big hug from whenever you get in her path. We lived in a ranch house that my dad built. My parents are here. You didn't know I was going to talk about you today, did I? Yeah, I love this. The horror on their faces is really nice. My mom bought our clothes at Walmart and Sears, and we had a great middle class, very rural life. But I have a disclaimer to make. I'm an overcomplicator. My mother has told me in so many words that my spiritual gift is actually overcomplicating things. If you ask me to plan a birthday party, I hire a circus. It's just my personality, and I get really focused, and it's hard to distract. So I'm telling you this because I tend not to be very observant. I do not notice things that other people notice, mainly because I'm focused on the circus. And the other day I had somebody say, hey, did you see the big Lincoln statue? I'm like, no, where? And they're like, right outside your window, like right there, that big, huge guy. And I had a friend recently, I said, when did you get a new car? And she said, 3 years ago. Like, so I've got some issues. But I do remember every detail about the first time I noticed a difference in the way people were housed. And when it comes to housing, I get really nosy fast. I had a girlfriend in grade school to live with her dad, her stepmother, and her siblings. And I was at their house, and she needed something from her bedroom. So we went to her bedroom, and I quickly noticed that it was a screened-in front porch that she shared in this old farmhouse. And I was too young to put my finger on it, but I knew one thing. I knew when it got cold out there, she was sleeping in the cold. And there was no amount of plastic that you can put over the screened-in windows that was going to do anything about that. And I teach Sunday school to first through fourth graders, and I noticed something the other day. I teach in Clarendon Hills, and I had a child pray out loud that she was thankful that her mom was able to buy a new bed for her and her sister to share. And better than that, the kid went on to say that she recognized she didn't need that bed. It was a want. And boy, how much more comfortable it was because she had that bed. And you can better believe that got my attention fast. I also met two new friends. Kay was at the same event as I was last week that were for veterans. And both of these veterans had experienced deep loss. One had lost a spouse, and the other had lost a friend in active duty. And both of them went to a bad place fast. And both ended up being homeless, living in their cars. And due to that permanent supportive housing and the investment that they're getting in support services, they're both thriving and living independently in their own apartments now. Here's another friend. He's one of my most favorite people on the face of the earth, and his name's Josh. Josh was living in his parents' basement in Wheaton, and all I can say is he was an expert gamer, okay? He was 24 years old, and he was really not using his time the best. But now, because of permanent supportive housing, he lives alone. He has keys to his own apartment. He has a lease that he signed. He lives alone, he cooks, he cleans for himself, he's able to do his laundry by himself, and he has a part-time job. And Josh once told me that he wanted three things in life. He wanted to not live in his parents' basement to live alone, he wanted a job, and he wanted a girlfriend. Right? Who can't relate to that, right? 25 years old, that's what we all want. That's what I still want today, right? I want independence, I want meaningful work, and I want love, right? I mean, that's a pretty basic human things. And because of Josh, you're gonna meet him a little bit later in the presentation, he got all those things through permanent supportive housing. I'm thankful to Governor Rauner and the IDA board to be at the Illinois Housing Development Authority because we get to help a lot of people. And I'm having a ball, and I'm thankful to be here. I worked for Bob Schillerstrom in DuPage County years ago. I was running their federal program, CDBG, home program, and ESG. And any of you that know who that means, God bless you. We focused a lot on housing. Then I worked for the Village of Villa Park as their zoning administrator during the boom. I attended a lot of public hearings and developed this lovely layer of thick skin I have. We like to call that rhinoceros hide. It's something that only one can develop if you're in the zoning world. And then in 2002, I started a consulting firm that helped nonprofits and municipal government strategize on financial housing and how to actually get housing committed in their communities. And I ran the Kane County Continuum of Care for 12 years that really looked at how do you end homelessness. I also helped start a nonprofit that developed mostly permanent supportive housing for people with disabilities. It has been one of the best teaching experiences of my life, being thrown into the development world. And I'm happy to be at IDA because IDA is such a unique entity. We are quasi-governmental, we're self-supporting, and we like to call ourselves a mission-driven lender. We look and we act a lot like a bank, but we would be the worst bank in the world because no good bank would make the decisions that we make, right? We cap our profit, and we're able to make low-interest loans on the single-family side and the multifamily side because of that. In fiscal year 2016, IDA invested $1.4 billion in 10,000 units in Illinois, and we generated $640 million in the Illinois economy that created 7,400 jobs, and we're particularly proud of that. But what we're most, yeah. But what we're most proud about is all the people that we helped get in affordable housing, because we know housing matters, and it makes a difference in all of our communities. IDA was created in 1967 with a very clear mission. It's to create and preserve affordable housing. It was created as an independent corporate body with an active board. King Harris, our board chair, is here today. And we're thrilled, yes, clap for King. We have our own credit scores and assets, and we must generate our own revenue to survive. IDA has a 50-year track record of responsible fiscal management. We're proud that our credit scores are A1, AA minus, and AA minus through Moody's, Standard & Poor's, and Fitch. And we hold those very dear. And we're constantly making banking decisions, if you will, mission-driven lender decisions with that balancing act in place. How can we serve well? How can we preserve our credit ratings? And how can we help a lot of people? We are a financial institution and a lender. And again, I'm going to talk a lot today about the units and the jobs that we produce, but we don't want to lose sight of the goal. At the end of the day, somebody's getting keys and moving into one of our units. Mm-hmm. So every single county in the state, all 102 of them, have at least one IDA success story. And they often go something like this. A family bought their first home with down payment assistance from IDA. Or a senior on a fixed income was able to stay in their community because they're able to move into an apartment in town. Or a homeowner avoided foreclosure and was able to use IDA's mortgage payment assistance. Or a local government found resources to tear down those blighted homes. Or a person with disability for the first time is able to live independently. So those are the types of services that we're doing all over the state. We know that housing's more than just a roof and four walls. Housing impacts the trajectory of a person's life, just like my friends I talked about earlier. Housing's the foundation of a healthy economy. It's a stepping stone to job creation. It's a good schools to transportation, healthcare, and even groceries. Even what you eat, think about it, is if you live near a grocery store or you don't. How you eat even is impacted by where you live. As Jay mentioned, I'm an urban planner, and I know that great housing is an indicator of community health. And when the housing's booming, guess what? Your community's booming too. And sadly, the same's true when housing weakens. The entire community tends to suffer. So in addition to the financial and emotional tolls they take on the individual families, foreclosures have negatively impact on local housing values, impacts the school districts, harm the broader economy, and create direct costs for local governments. A Chicago case study found that every single house that is foreclosed costs local government between, direct costs, by the way, $5,000 to $34,000. And then more indirect cost, it's more like $55,000 for every single house. This is a big deal. A study from the Woodcock Institute found that in low and moderate income neighborhoods, properties decrease by 1.8% for each foreclosure on the block. So if you do the math, and you have a $200,000 house, so for every foreclosure on your block, you're losing $3,600 on your house, and you did nothing, right, except live there. So if you had two foreclosures on your block, your $200,000 house is now worth $192,000. So this is a big deal for a lot of our municipal friends to tackle with. And we also know that if you're in that position as a homeowner, you're not investing a dime, right? It doesn't make financial sense. You're not going to fix the roof. You're not going to do any extra rehab because you know at that point that you don't have the value in your home. So the good news is a study from the University of Pennsylvania says that every dollar invested in demolition equals a $14 increase in neighbors' properties. And I know that there's a point where people don't like to talk about demo, but there's also a point where it's absolutely the right thing to do. Another point is every dollar invested just to clean and green a vacant lot, there are an increase in neighbors' properties for $224. Invest a dollar, get 224 out in a neighborhood rising property values. So we're happy that we're a part of that in our community investment programs. Housing is also important to economic health, and is we understand that homeownership is a cornerstone to stable communities. As many of you know, most of us, house is the most significant form of wealth that we have. It's in that equity of our single family home. The National Association of Realtors estimates that one job is created for every two house sales. One job for every two house sales. And the sale of a single family home generates $60,000 for the economy. And that's through expenditures in construction, in rehab, in retail trade, transportation, financial, title services, real estate professionals, sales, and public administration. Housing even matters in education. Dr. Sandra Newman from Johns Hopkins University found that families who could truly afford housing, and we consider that a person paying or a household paying 30% or less of their income for housing, they say that families who truly obtain affordable housing spend more money on enrichment for their children, and that results in better cognitive development for their children. And we know when that doesn't happen, it spills over into our classrooms, and our teachers are dealing with this every day. Housing is also important to the quality of life and health. The World Health Organization specifically names housing as a key driver of individual health. And this statistic blows me away. It says social determinants, including health, including housing in neighborhoods, are responsible for 40% of an individual health outcomes. So where you live affects how healthy you are. The healthcare industry and the insurance providers are figuring this out too. The New York Times recently reports that hospitals in New Jersey and Boston are working with local housing authorities to get vouchers for their patients. So we're not talking like workforce housing, where they're trying to get vouchers for their employees, or they're trying to decrease absenteeism because people are living too far to get to work. They're actually talking about getting these vouchers for their patients. Some hospitals have even created housing divisions that they are acting like real estate developers, like many of you in the room, buying, renovating, and renting building to patients. Insurance providers like Universal Healthcare, I'm sure you all recognize that name, have invested more than $350 million to build 56 developments across the country in 14 states since 2011 because they see the link between housing and healthcare and they're willing to invest in it. Those statistics blow me away. One more. The MacArthur Foundation, in a 2013 study, tied between quality of housing and children's health, found that poor housing quality and residential instability of that housing was the most consistent and strongest predictor of emotional and behavioral health in adolescence. I want to say it one more time because poor housing quality, intermittent housing was the most consistent and strong predictor of emotional and behavioral health. We have to be doing more because there's too much at stake. One more, because this is about the incremental nature of this. So when we think about housing instability, oftentimes you think of people moving from one place to another, which is absolutely true. But it's also talking about homelessness, and there's plenty of you in the room that are working with homeless people right now. The Children's Health Watch found that when compared to children that have never experienced homelessness, children whose mothers that were homeless during pregnancy but housed after birth, those children were 20%, had more than 20% likely to be hospitalized. But if you have someone that has been homeless pre and postnatal, so the child, the mother was pregnant while living in a homeless shelter, and then also after and goes back to a homeless shelter, those children are 41% more likely to be hospitalized. So this is unbelievable to me, because confession time, both my husband and I turned into baby people. We didn't know we were baby people until we had children of our own, and now every time we see babies, we're like gaga. And, you know, my husband says he's been rewired somehow. And when I see children at homeless shelters, and I'm sure some of you have volunteered and you've seen families at homeless shelters, or I even see a kid on the street that looks dirty, it's upsetting. So to think that we have people in the United States today that are living in homeless shelters, especially children, is disgraceful to me. It is. We've got a lot of work to do, and we're excited about doing it. I want to tell you about a couple other friends that I met a few years ago at a residential meet and greet in Springfield. We were at a new apartment building, and these three young men came into a room, and it was kind of like, just meet the residents and see how they liked the building and what was going on in their lives. And they came in, and the first thing they said to me was, sorry, we can't stay long, we're going to work. And this was permanent supportive housing, and I thought, ooh, somebody's going to work, okay. So that my ears picked up, I noticed that. And then these three young men were all in their 20s. And okay, they're young people, they're living independently, okay, that's good. And then I started asking, what's your favorite thing about living in this building? And all three of them said it pretty much the same way. We love cooking whenever we want to cook. We like eating the food we want to eat, and we like being able to eat whenever we want to. And to me, that's code for I lived in an institution before. So I feel like everyone deserves privacy in their life. So I didn't dig anymore, but I kept following these guys. And every time I was around, I tried very hard to kind of get to know them to figure out what their stories were. And they ended up telling me that all three of them were living in a nursing home for 6 to 7 years. Yeah. And now they're living independently, and they're able to, all three of them were going to work. They're working part-time at the Y in Springfield. So how does that happen? So one of these guys in particular has become a friend, and he ended up telling me a story and told me I could share it. And he was in a nursing home. That's where he started this journey. But he was from a family, didn't know his father. The mom was inconsistent at best. And he ended up in high school, started having what was considered at the time just bad behavior. We realize now he was having the symptoms of mental health and behavioral health issues. But at the time, he just thought he was having bad behavior. And he ended up finding out that he needed medication. He ended up living in a nursing home with about 100 other people. Well, he graduated from that program, ended up in a group home, and at that group home, he lived with 7 other people that he did not know. They had full-time care, and when the people at the group home, when they needed to go to the grocery store, they all went together. If they wanted to go bowling, everyone had to go. It's just the rules of the way it worked. But he ended up getting into permanent supportive housing at this building, and he has a job. This is one of the guys that was at the Y. He has a car. He has a big screen TV. He loves NASCAR, so a bunch of other residents do too, and they come to his unit and they watch this big screen TV. It's really cool. I mean, he has a really fulfilling, wonderful life, and it was because of permanent supportive housing. One other piece I want to tell you, he sent me a photo not too long ago, and in this photo were these two older people, and I thought, who are those people? Because I knew his parents weren't in his life. And I asked, and he told me it was a big brother from a big brother, big sister program. And since he was 15 years old, this guy and his wife have taken him out for dinner and a movie all this time. So kudos to all of you that invest in people that are vulnerable. Thank you for all of you that take the time to maybe, it's tough love sometimes, right? It's tough love sometimes when you're meeting people that are very different than you, or maybe you have to decide whether they're in a crisis point in their life or they just have odd behavior, right? Some of these people are in that category. And so thanks to all of you that care for these folks. But that made a difference in his life, and he's living completely independently now. So that's the human side of the story, but it's also the economic side of the story, because permanent supportive housing is, there's value in cost. It's estimated that permanent supportive housing costs about $27,000 a year. Nursing homes is about $52,000, jails about $52,000, institutions for folks with developmental disabilities is $54,000. So we can do better at this. And IDA's been investing about, since 2000, in the last 5 years, we've invested about 15% of our portfolio to permanent supportive housing to give these folks an opportunity to live in the community. And we're really, really proud of that. I'm going to tell you a little bit about our single family program. Through IDA, we have a network of about 150 banks. I've seen some familiar faces in the room of those banks. And we invested last year $875 million in loans that were to first-time homebuyers. And that we helped about 6,000 first-time homebuyers get into homes. In the past 2 years, 11% of the first-time homebuyers in Illinois purchased their first home through an IDA loan, and that's regardless of whether it's affordable or not. So 11% of the single family market is coming from IDA. 23% of our IDA home buyers are minorities, and we're pretty pleased about that. And 67% of our home buyers were millennials, so born after 1982. So I think kudos to our single family team and our banking partners and our marketing team, because there are many other states that are having a very tough time getting millennials to stay. And we've really found in Illinois, they're the talent that we need, and we're happy that they're staying in Illinois and investing. Even in Centralia, the hometown of our friend Stella Black, that we're finding their mayor is telling us that they're finding young people are staying in Centralia. That's a town of 13,000 people, and we've been able to invest $1.9 million. So if it can happen in small towns like this across Illinois, we're really happy we're getting a stronghold into that single family market. And on the multifamily side, we were able to invest $512 million and leveraged an additional $230 million to preserve and create about 4,000 apartments last year. And that's in 47 different developments. We have about 120,000 apartments that we're monitoring right now through our asset management program. So we're thrilled about that. And one out of every 16 apartments in Illinois, that's about 6%, is IDA financed. And this includes all rental housing again, not just affordable. So there's a deep reach in the multifamily marketplace too. We also been able to grant around $2 million in the last couple years to secure and demolish 600 single family and abandoned homes to local governments. An additional $1 million has been granted to foreclosure mitigation counseling agencies to 3,700 struggling home buyers. And again, we have a lot more work to do in this area. The foreclosure crisis is over for some people, but it's not over for many, many others. We were awarded an additional $220 million from the Department of Treasury for our Hardest Hit Fund, and we've reopened the Hardest Hit Fund program that gives help to struggling home buyers. It's up to $35,000 for temporary mortgage assistance due to loss of income. And another program that we're super excited about that we've just launched is called iRefi. And this is for underwater home buyers. So these are for folks that owe more on their mortgage than what their house is worth. And we're able to help them come upright by giving them a grant up to $50,000 to get their mortgage right side up. It's a grant that's forgiven over 3 years. And then we're refinancing the mortgage product for them. The beautiful thing is we're finding that most people don't need a full $50,000. Our average is about $38,000. And because of the refinancing at a more favorable interest rate, people are saving about $360 a month. Now, if I put my municipal hat on, I am a local government official, I'm saying great, because you know what? They've not been investing in their home. Right? If you're underwater, once again, you're not investing. So people are going to have a little bit extra more money a month that they're able to go ahead and fix the roof, fix the fence, and do the other maintenance work around their home. So as we talked a little bit before, IDA has been really happy to be helping solve the homelessness problem and looking through how we can help in the unnecessary institutionalization in Illinois. So we have a video to show you of a young man that I talked about, Josh, and where we understand that housing is more than just a house over his head. This will just take a couple minutes.
He's not doing a whole lot except staying in his room watching movies and TV and playing his video games and trying to get out of the house as much as he can. And it was just there was conflict. I mean, because he wasn't doing a whole lot at home. He wasn't doing laundry. He wasn't doing his own grocery shopping. He wasn't keeping his bedroom very neat. He wasn't keeping his bathroom very neat. He wasn't cooking. When we heard about the supported housing, Josh came home. Actually, he called me and said, hey, there's this opportunity. And we were like, well, wait a minute. You know, this is happening too fast. And we asked the questions of the appropriate people and looked more. We sought out information. We were just really apprehensive. And between my husband and I, the discussion that we had is, you know, we didn't know if Josh was ready. We didn't know if he was ready, if he could do this, if he could live on his own. What would the makeup of the building be with the other residents? He has a developmental disability. There's also people with mental illness here. How was that gonna work? And so we were really, really hesitant. And I remember we both said, you know, we're gonna, if we just let, and this was actually particularly me, if I just let my fear hold us back, that's not enough reason to not let Josh try this.
Now I feel like this was a great choice and a great opportunity for me, and I'm really happy to be here, honestly. I'm so proud that I can just do this. No, I would not want to live in a group home because, as I said before, that if the group home, if they all went on an outing, I would have to go, and some of those people are, most of them are monitored 24/7, and I do not need that. What I did need help with, and before I moved in this building, cleaning, for sure, laundry, making meals. I don't need help with that stuff. I know how to do it now. But what I do feel like True Trinity has helped me discover my potential here. This building has helped me.
The huge thing that we see is the growth and in responsibility and just the overall growth. Josh is happier. He's taking more initiative. He's taking care of himself. I mean, he's only stayed overnight, I think, back at home. We're 15 minutes from here. Like, I think you stayed two nights at our house.
Yeah.
I can't get him to come back home.
The things I really want in life are right now is a place to live, and I got that covered. I want a girlfriend, and I wanted a job, which I got down. Since I found my job at Trinity, I'm pretty happy. The need for permanent supportive housing is really there because I am living here, and I'm the proof of actually how much permanent supportive housing means. Thank you, Ida, and congratulations on your 50 years.
Thanks. I've learned that decent, safe, affordable, and attractive housing stabilizes families. Permanent supportive housing changes life, just like Josh's. A minimal amount of support services sometimes is the difference between someone living in a community and someone living in an institution. And a mix of housing types is healthy for the entire community and for our state. Thank you all for your help. Bye-bye.
Thank you very much, Director Hamernik. And now questions coming down. I think I'm going to get a couple of questions here. I'll start off by asking you this. We understand the difficulty of the housing market over the last sort of 8-10 years, right? And it's obvious from your remarks that you're participating in multifamily and you're participating in specialty and you're also in single family. What is the health of the overall Illinois housing marketplace today? And does that impact your ability to participate in those sectors?
I think it comes back to where you live. I think it's very different in where your house is at right now and how healthy your community is, unfortunately. You know, we have some communities where we have folks that, I was with the Southside mayor recently, and he has 400 vacant, blighted, abandoned homes. That's so tough, right? And then you're in other marketplaces where they're booming. So I think it all goes back to where you are where you're at. Ida has products that can help those mayors. I wish we had more, because we could be doing this all day. But I think we're in good shape. We're certainly better than when poor Mary Kinney was here a few years ago. That was much tougher, right? You were in the middle of the crash.
Terrific, thank you. Here is from Nick Brunick, who is with Applegate and Thorne Thompson. Here's the question. Can you talk about what Ida is doing through its production programs to help private developers create and preserve more affordable rental housing?
Sure, I'm happy to talk about that. So he's talking about our multifamily side. Nick, where are you? I didn't see you. Hey. In the last year, we've quadrupled our first mortgage lending products. We're really proud about that, and I think that we're offering more and more products and trying to be more and more flexible, some with risk share, some with other HUD products, but mostly we're in the permanent position, but sometimes we're doing construction financing. So I think that we're setting ourselves up for a great year this year. And we're certainly doing lots on the bond side as well, 4% tax credits.
Okay, David Hulsberg became a City Club member on Monday. Thank you, David. Where are you, David? Way to go, great idea. Affiliation, Invest Aurora. And David says, in the advent of the Trump factor, with tax credits being devalued, what is your suggestion for getting deals done?
I think it depends a lot on your project, on whether or not your tax credits are devalued. I just met a couple people here today saying that they have really, really healthy net equity raises. So I think it also depends on location and whether you're doing new construction or rehab. So with that said, you know, we're filling gaps the best we can. On the 2016 deals, we've made that our priority to help those projects get through before we hit the 2017 deals. Those are due in June. And by the way, we are committed to have those being done electronic this year. So woohoo, no more paper. But we have trust fund. We have Illinois tax credits, and thanks to the folks in the state legislature for extending that program. So we're filling the gaps. So far, so good. And I do think that we're going to see changes in the net cent rates.
And from Peter Holston of Holston Development, where is the state of Illinois in meeting the transition goals set by the Olmsted-related consent decrees? That's not Frederick. No. Olmsted-related. We were talking about Frederick Law Olmsted. Thank you.
You know, we have over 4,000 units in our portfolio right now, permanent supportive housing, and we need to double it. We're getting there. As you know, there's 3 consent decrees. There's not just the one. We also have a permanent supportive housing round that was dedicated just for small properties, 25 units or less, 100% permanent supportive housing. And those applications are in, and we're hoping to take those May, June board. So we're getting there, but we have a lot of work to do. The need is really great, and we have folks leaving institutions that need to be housed, but we still haven't shut that front door, so there's still people coming into the institutions.
Ladies and gentlemen, some applause for Audra Hamernik.